Thank you so much for your patience and participation. So, ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the last edition, the season finale of season 2 finale of the Bliss Catchers. And this is edition number 22. So, as you know, we don't have an edition on for the Bliss Catchers in December, but we are heading towards the 25th edition of this in the third season. So it's fantastic to see the event growing. Thank you, Ramesh, for signaling that we can get started. Ramesh has been our Astana Bliss Catcher follower. So he's attended all the editions of Bliss Catchers over the last two seasons. So amazing. Thank you, Ramesh. So I was looking out for you, and I'm glad you're back here. So let me start quickly by, before I introduce my guest this evening, to quickly talk about why we do Bliss Catchers. The simple perspective is this. Life is a limited period offer. And in this lifetime, we have to maximize the opportunity available to us. And many of us, because of our context, circumstances, conditioning, insecurities, and the jobs that we keep to earn a living, keep postponing living and keep postponing doing what we love doing. So the Bliss Catcher event is something that invites people to pause and reflect. And to help us do this, we curate the stories of very interesting people that have taken this journey of following their bliss. Now, following your bliss is not an original idea. It was first proposed by Joseph Campbell, the American mythologist and author. And his perspective is very powerful. He said, if you follow your bliss, then doors will open where you only saw walls, and only you will be able to see those doors. This is something incredible as a perspective and incredible as a reality, because we tend to postpone what we love doing, because when we start thinking about what we want to do, we see a wall and we say, there is a no-go there. I don't think I can head in that direction. But Campbell says, follow your bliss, go after it, and doors will open. Vani, my wife, and I have seen this happen to us. And as we speak, we are almost getting into the 10th year of a very cathartic phase in our life, a bankruptcy. And we have found that in this time, when there has been no work coming our way, or no money coming our way, or both at times, what has kept us anchored is and happy is the fact that we are doing only stuff that makes us happy. Now, I wrote my book, Fall Like a Rose Petal, to talk about this journey of ours and to share how, if you decide, you can be happy and content even without money. Last week, a reader of the book reminded me of a bliss catcher in the book. And suddenly I realized, hey, I've not talked about it in my Bliss Catcher event at all. So those of you who have read this book, or those of you who will read this book, will find that the foreword is written by an amazing man called Bedabrata Payne. Bedo, as we call him, is a NASA scientist. And he quit around his age of 40 plus. He quit his job at NASA. Now, if you can't relate to NASA, relate to your mobile phone. The camera, the digital camera technology in your mobile phone is patented by Bedo. So Bedo had this huge career going for him as a scientist, as an inventor, and then the bug bit him, and the bliss bug bit him. And his bliss was making a film, and he wanted to make an Indian film. So he gives up everything in the US, winds up and moves personally. He leaves his family there but moves to India and makes this amazing film called Chittagong, which is based on the Chittagong Mutiny. Now, around the time that this film was being made, many things in his life fell apart. His older son died while shaving out of an electric shock in Los Angeles. That's how weird it can get. Okay? He was using an electric razor, and while shaving, he died of electrocution. His wife was not able to bear this grief. It broke up their marriage. And Bedo went penniless, putting all his money into Chittagong, the film. And around that time, Ashutosh Gawarikar made a film called Khele Hum Ji Jaan Se, starring Abhishek Bachchan. And the story goes that the Bachchan clan, I'm a devotee of Amitabh Bachchan, but this is the way the story goes, that the Bachchan clan did all that was possible to sabotage the chances of Chittagong getting released ahead of Ashutosh Gawarikar's film. Ashutosh's film didn't do well. Chittagong was finally released, and Bedo got a call from Mr. Bachchan himself, senior, saying, "I wish I had done this film with you. I wish you had given me a role in this film." So when Bedo and I got talking about the foreword to my book, Bedo told us about all this, and I'm reminded of a perspective that Campbell put out. He said, in following your bliss, you're actually embarking on a journey of adventure. And this adventure is necessarily dangerous. There is going to be positives and there are going to be negatives in terms of possibilities. And all of them are beyond your control. Then he clarifies and he says, whether you take the route of your bliss or not, all life is an adventure. And all life is necessarily dangerous. The only advantage when you are following your bliss is that you are happier going through that adventure. Happier going through that unpredictability. Happier doing what you love doing. So, that is the reason why we curate the Bliss Catchers every month on the last Saturday. And this evening, I have two wonderful guests here, Sandeep and Srikanth. You can see the wonderful men in black, you know, the color coordinated. Okay. And I'm in white, so it's kind of, you know, gonna, and there's a dash of colors over there, so all of this is going to help us keep the evening alive and charged.
Trousers are all matching.
Trousers are all matching. That's a good observation. I missed that. You know, I missed that when I first thought about their shirts. So, let me introduce my guests this evening. I'm going to request people to open up some more chairs there and put some here. Oh, we have seats there. Okay, nice. So, I didn't meet Sandeep until recently, but I heard him. Of course, I've heard his music, but I heard him speak about his journey from the US to India, to Chennai, because of his love for Carnatic music, because of his passion to perform. And I heard him at one of the coffee shops, the Genius coffee shop, a couple of years ago. And I kind of tucked it away that we will have him as our guest at the Bliss Catchers. So thank you, Sandeep, for accepting that. Apart from being a very accomplished singer in the last decade particularly, what I think is very, very beautiful about Sandeep's journey is the choice to follow your bliss, give up what many will consider an all-set career in the US. He has a undergrad degree in law and society from the University of California, Santa Barbara. And his family lives there in California. So giving up all of that for his bliss and coming to Chennai, and anybody wanting to enter the music circuit in the Sabha circuit in Chennai know how difficult it is. For all of that, I think Sandeep's story is very, very exciting, and I'm sure you're waiting to hear it from him as we get talking. So once again, welcome Sandeep. For this evening. Srikanth And I owe Srikanth's presence here to a wonderful, wonderful friend of ours, Janaki over there. Janaki is very close to Vani and me, and she said, "You have to meet this man, you have to meet this man." And I didn't bite into it, honestly, until I saw Margari Raghav and one with T.M. Krishna. I have not seen a Rajinikanth film first day, first show. I have not seen an Amitabh Bachchan film first day, first show. But I have seen a T.M. Krishna film first day, first show. And that was your film. So, you know, so thank you so much for being here. Srikanth is that Chamatta damp ramp, you know, who typically should have been counted somewhere in one of the multinational companies and probably, you know, traveling continents, being part of the rat race. But he decided early on that that's not the life he wanted. He went into stock trading. He made a lot of money. He lost a lot of money. But in the process, and what you will hear today is lessons from life that he learned and how he employs those lessons in investing in completely creative endeavors, like making a film on Carnatic music, and not just one, but two. And then investing in a creative, passionate pursuit, like a space, like a physical space for exploration. If you've not heard of this place, you must look them up on Facebook and go visit them in Palavakkam. It's called the Learning Community at Quest, which is just the most beautiful place that you can ask for children, for adults, to explore new forms of learning. In a way, I think you're breeding bliss catchers there. In a way, you may end up breeding bliss catchers there. So thank you, Srikanth, for being here. So may I invite both of you now to join me, Srikanth and Sandeep. Wonderful having you. So let's get your mics going. So the format we will be following is we will go over a conversation between us for the next 30 to 40 minutes, and then we will open up the conversation for the audience, where you can interact with the guests and ask them your questions, and then we will close as usual with our very, very popular segment, which is the quiz segment, where these fabulous mugs that T.S. Ashwin and his team at Odyssey always put together. These are mugs to die for, and you'll see people competing for the answers. There's a collection coming up in some people's homes. That's the last segment, and then we will, as usual, by this clock, end our session at 8:29, 8:30. So, thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Let's get started. So, all set?
Sure.
Feeling good?
Yeah.
Okay, I'll possibly start with you, Srikanth. So I think we made the, unveiled your Chamatta Tambram credentials, and we have talked about you're not wanting to be a bean counter, and you're diving into stock trade. Okay? Can you tell us a little bit about that phase when you must have been, 25, in your mid-20s, when you took this decision not to possibly hold a full-time job and get into stock trading, or was it a little later? But whenever that phase happened, what were the primary factors that drove you away from the rat race?
Thank you for having us here. It's wonderful to be here. Thank you all for coming. So my foray into stocks, I think, started from with an interest primarily to stocks, which was inculcated, I think, from my grandfather, who was a lawyer in Coimbatore, and he was a prolific investor and speculator too. In World War II days, he had speculated and lost a lot of money, stocking besides making money. So, very early childhood, when I used to spend time in Coimbatore, I had learned unconsciously, not that I wanted to learn, but it was all around me. I had learned so much about stocks. And so when I qualified as a CA, I had joined Parry as a management trainee, and then I was working there. Even then, I was actively trading in stocks. When I finished my chartered accountancy, my grandfather gifted me 5,000 rupees and I invested in two stocks with that, which turned out, you know, it was like a commencement of a journey there actually. It's not, I was aware of it, but it just started off a journey which, you know, to be honest, in 85 I was making more money on stocks and then in 1991 happened. That is the I must have been 24, 25. I was married by then, and Harshad Mehta was, you know, all over the place. And then I was one of those professionals who chucked up our jobs and then went to Bombay, you know, in search of gold, so to speak. I thought I had the skill sets for it and I had the passion for it, but I never knew how I was going to do it. My friend with whom Gita and I did a CA, he had a stockbroking firm. He offered me a position in his firm in Bombay to do with government securities trading. And we went to Bombay actually. That is 1990. 1991 was heady days, and then, you know, all of you know what happened after that. You know, the crash and the security scam and all of that. And there started the cycle of ups and downs. So yeah, that's pretty much it is. Getting into stocks was not like a, you know, a thought out decision, but it's something I just followed because you know, I was interested in it and I saw myself you know, making a career for myself.
There was your grandfather's kind of background there.
Absolutely.
If that 5,000 had probably not been given to you, life would have been different.
Maybe. There's another angle to it actually, because he had this thing of when I was doing CA, whenever I used to go to Coimbatore for my holidays, he used to give all his contract notes. The Kanaka Idra, he thought I was a hotshot budding chartered accountant who has to, you know, account for all his stocks. So the recording of all his transactions, and then I see, you know, what he was doing and the companies he was investing in, all became a part of me, very, very unconscious. And then I'm a great believer in that, because the people who I have associated with, who have influenced me to do whatever I've done, be where I am today. So that is a continuing theme through my life. I think it started with my grandfather.
Fantastic. One more question before I move to Sandeep. So you said you were married, Gita, you were married, and you took this decision to move to Bombay. How was that decision? Was it an easy decision? Was it a tough decision? Was it a let's do it kind of decision? How was it?
We were not just really thinking about it actually. We just said let's do it. So I remember Gita was she was pregnant at the time. We were expecting a child, Varun, who was born in 91 in Bombay. And the doctor, the elderly doctor there in Nanavati Hospital, the very, very old lady, Shankari, she said, "You moved to Bombay now? What are you, your parents are not with you, your mother is not, what are you doing? You're crazy, you go back to Chennai." "What are you doing here?" type of thing. So people had their opinions about this, you know, as to, you know, why I would do something like that. But, you know, honestly, I don't remember why I did it. It just happened. I mean, it's not something, definitely not a well thought out
So I would take away the fact that sometimes the word follow is just about follow. There is no analysis required, right? When you follow, there is a certain mindlessness to it. When you follow your bliss, drawing from Srikanth's experience or from my experience or from some of you who are sitting here, when you follow, you just follow. When you don't think, you don't question, you don't examine. And that is what Campbell championed. And he said, you know, if you follow, then doors will open. And obviously, Srikanth, so many doors have opened. And we'll come back to your story in a bit. But let's move to Sandeep there, young and happening Sandeep over there. So Sandeep, I understand that your father hails from Thiruvayur. Your mother is a music teacher herself. His two brothers, both are accomplished musicians in their own right. One of them, Nikhil, is it, who learned from Flute Ramani. And
Nirmal, who learned from Umyalpuram Shivrao.
Yeah. So there was, you know, and the story goes that at the age of four, Sandeep was already singing the songs that his mother was teaching other students in her Carnatic music class. So there was a great deal of immersion in music, if I can use that term, right? Even then, for a student who would have been probably in your early teens to decide to take a break year, or was it earlier? Please clarify that. To come to Chennai to just do a year of exploration in the Mecca of Carnatic music. You know, how did that decision come about? Was it again thought through? What were your parents' views, or was it you saying no and I can be thought of that I want to do this? How did it go?
Well, first of all, thanks for having me. It's my pleasure to be here with all of you today. To answer your question about the break year, I was 11 and I had just given a very small house concert in LA, my first public performance. And I don't know what got into my parents' heads, but they are actually the ones who wanted me to come to India for 1 year. And at that age, it was more of me just not really protesting. It was just, I didn't have the mentality that I, you know, wanted to do it, nor did I not want to do it. It was just sort of, at that age, kind of just going with the flow. And because I didn't put up too much of a fight, my parents took the opportunity to say, okay, then let's do it. You know, he's not fighting it too much. And I remember at that age, I had very weird demands and conditions under which I would come in. One of them was that I wanted to like bring one of my super soaker water guns, and so my mom packed it. It took up half a suitcase. But actually, my mom packed it, so I can find it, that's what it takes. But also, the other appealing aspect of the coming to India was that I didn't have to go to school for 1 year. So that's like, it's an 11-year-old's dream. So I didn't go to seventh grade, and I instead went for a music class 3 times a week, and I practiced, and I went to concerts. And so as you said, it was a lot of immersion in California compared to maybe another average household, even an average Indian household in the US, but it wasn't anything compared to being in Madras, which is the opportunity to go to concerts every day or to go to class more often, or that time to practice and that atmosphere where I don't have maybe the cultural demands of being in America, which is to say, you know, American friends who want to do American things and don't understand this side of me. That wasn't really something that I had to deal with being here. So that worked out really well.
And you trained that year with Calcutta K.S.Krishnamurthy.
Yes, that's the year that I, Flute Ramani Sir is the one who took me to KSK Mama and basically told him. At that time he was already teaching a lot of the great artists like Sanjay Subrahmanyam, Sudharaghunadam, Krishna. So 11-year-old boy was brought to him, and I think he looked at me like, what is this kid doing here? You know, he has no business. And then Ramani Sir just sort of said, do it as a personal favor to me, that I'm very close to his family, and you should take him on. And I remember after the first class, or second class maybe, he openly told me, he said, when you first came, I didn't know what to expect. I'm very pleasantly surprised. Now let's start the real class. And it was already the third time I was going. So the first 2 times he was just sort of gauging. And then said the third class, he said, now I'm going to start the real intense class for you. And that's when it really kicked in.
Okay, okay. Tell us a little bit about how that year helped when you look back now. I mean, obviously at that time you might not have been able to relate to it as well as you can now. So look back and tell us a little bit about that year and how kind of defining it was for your career in terms of a decision to go to the next stage of enrolling with Sanjay, for example.
Yeah, exactly. I think you kind of just said it right there, that it was one of many steps along the way. You know, I didn't know it at the time, obviously, but looking back, it was probably the first major step towards coming to where I am now, a full-time musician. That year made me more serious, made me more interested. I learned a lot. So that was when I was exposed to a lot more music here. I had already heard Sanjay Subrahmanyam's music before, but that's the year I became more of like an obsessive fan, following him around. And of course, K.S.K. Mama was okay with that because that's one of his prime disciples. And so he said, that's good, follow that style. so that worked out. And then it also was from that year I started to come to India every year, because that sort of, it just became the norm after that. Okay, I'm going to go back to India to learn music on my summer vacation. And then that slowly became, after 3 years, K.S.K. Mala passed away, and then I went to Sanjay and asked him. And then he was a little reluctant because he said, you've learned from such a great artist, why don't you go to somebody else, very senior, an older person.
So Sanjay wasn't teaching at that time?
Not really. He had one or two students who had just started from him. So he didn't have a whole lot of students. Even today he doesn't. But then it was very reluctant and very hesitant because he had a full schedule of his own performances. He agreed to take me on, and that just sort of...
Did it require some convincing from you? Okay.
It kind of did. Again, Ramani sir stepped in to the rescue, as he did many times in my life with music. He came and he just basically told Sanjay, no, I'm telling you, teach him. Just do it, you know, sort of a thing. And you can't say no to a man of that stature. So he said, okay, fine.
And that's how it happened.
Yeah, more or less. He knew I was already a big fan. We knew him personally. We approached him, and it worked out for me on many levels, because I could, in the classroom, I was more than ready to learn from him. You know, I looked up to him as an artist, seeing him on stage. But now I could actually learn one-on-one. And then outside of the classroom, I could talk to him about basketball or anything, you know, sports, other types of music, generally school. He was open to all topics of discussion, and so that was perfect for, you know, a 13, 14-year-old kid from the U.S.
Fantastic. Two very important points. Point number one is there is a grandfather in the story, and then there are parents in that story. So somebody kind of opens the road, you know, says this is the way. And in a way, unprotesting and following kind of helps, right? And then he talked about flute Ramani more than once, and then K.S.K. Mama more than once, in the context of helping him along the journey. And this is what Campbell talks about, you know, that people will come in your zone of bliss. You don't expect them to come in, but people will come in your zone of bliss. Around the time when Sanjay was, you know, when you went to train with Sanjay, perhaps, was when Sanjay's career itself was taking off as a standalone solo musician, vocalist. And, you know, he might not even have thought of the fact that he could teach people and develop them into a next generation of talent. So it's wonderful that Ramani kind of stepped in and did this for you. So people will come in, and I think we expect to see the people first before we make our choices, and I think they are waiting for us to make the choices. The universe is waiting for them to walk into your zone, provided you have entered the zone yourself. So thank you Sandeep for walking us up to that point. We'll come back to your story in a bit. Let's go back to Srikanth. Srikanth, a stock trader's life is fraught with risks, right? And risks of a very, very material kind, right? And we live in an era of, by the way, this is the first Bliss Catcher session after demonetization. we live in an era of, you know, cash going up in smoke, right? What did you learn about life in that phase of, like, roughly 15 years that you were, I mean, you are in stock trading even now, but
yeah.
But in the phase of building up your portfolio and building up your business of stock trading, what did you learn about life in terms of making, losing, all those upheavals that you went through?
Yeah, so we're talking of, in terms of timeline, a decade before, I figured out whether I was standing or sitting in the market. So the earliest experience was in 91, when, it was 80 days as we all, like everyone around me, entered the market when it was in a really, full phase. You think this is life. And we were, in 91, we had a child, and then Varun was maybe a few months old, and then we were looking at buying an apartment, somewhere in South Bombay. That was the, and by then, actually, we got into actually trading into government bonds, which is highly risky. We had no concept of what risk is and what reward is. So the whole essence of trading or investing is knowing your personality type and being that personality and then managing your risks accordingly. And that takes a hell of a long time. You can get wiped out before you figure that out. So this is the earliest lesson, and then we had actually, the firm where we had taken a position on the government bond, which just crashed. And before we knew it, the whole world, you know, on I think it was March 91, when everything seemed so different. And after that, you know, it was just the next step, you know. So what do we do next? We came back to Chennai and, you know, hung around for a while. For a long time, there was nothing happening in the market. I got into equities. And, you know, then equities has its own risk. In those days, before the electronic trading came in, it is completely a market which is, dominated by few players. It was like a club. And young professionals like us had no information or the absence of, perfect lines of, access to information. We pretty much were nowhere, actually. So what that changed was through the journey, the electronic trading kind of leveled the playing field. There's so many changes which happened post 91 in stock markets, which is flattened the field and leveled the field, and which offered, like, everybody was equal, and then they gave a chance to actually for people, professionals like us, to grow, and pretty much we grew with the system. So through that, like, coming back to the lessons, it's just a certain detachment and to focus on the process and not, because you're in this particular, you're always dealing with money. The raw material is money, your finished product is money, it's just turning around money. So when you're actually focused on how much you're having or how much you want to make, you're focusing on an outcome and you're not focusing on the process. And that takes, that's having a very difficult, unlike any other manufacturing or any other, where there is a process. And there's a very fixed process. Here there's no fixed process. There's a universe of assets, financial assets. And there's multiple ways you can actually invest in them, trade in them, either short term, long term, whatever. And to figure out what works for you and to stick to that and then to consistently do that and then make that plan work for you is something which is very, very difficult. And these biases you have and you're in your own ability and you sometimes think you're the king of the world, that biases can actually kill you. So a certain detachment from successes and failures is very, very essential, which is what biggest lessons I have learned. Apart from the material wealth is there for the world to see, but as far as I am concerned, these lessons, if you can actually translate that into other aspects of your life, have the same detachment, I think life is a lot easier. And I try to practice that in other aspects of my life. I think that's the biggest lesson or biggest thing which my profession, what I've done is.
That's your biggest wealth.
Absolutely.
Your way, right? How beautiful is this? Detach from the outcomes and focus on the process. I think we end up doing exactly the opposite. We focus a lot on the outcomes and detach from the processes, which is why many of the times we lead suboptimal or less qualitative lives. So in summary, what I'm picking up is that the dealing with material wealth, money being the raw material, money being the outcome, kind of taught you to learn the art of being detached and enjoying the process more than the result itself, right? And in a way, when we say the journey is the reward, this is what we mean. That the journey of life itself is the reward, because you're not going to take anything from here. So the biggest wealth is to be able to live that life fully and vibrantly and happily. And that is the process of life that we need to learn to enjoy. Then look at the outcome in terms of how much I made or how famous I am, or do I have a house or two houses, four cars or whatever, right? I want to ask you, how much has this learning really come in the form of your deciding to invest in completely, you know, unsure, no idea of returns, and completely uncharted territory, like making films on Carnatic music, right? So how did Agam Films come about, and how did you enter into that zone of becoming the creative investor that you are?
First of all, thanks so much for the tagline. I complimented that you. Thank you on Facebook, and I really mean it, because so many paths, so many journeys, so many people in my life, and I follow many of these paths. So if somebody asks me what I am today, what do I do, and so I find it genuinely difficult to actually describe it. and so that creative investor, my friends have been ragging me about it, but yeah. So Agal Films, again, I was talking to you about the continuing theme of people influencing, came about because of my interaction with Jayendra, a very good friend of mine, and then we used to golf together. And so we were these two people, silent people on the golf course who never used to talk to others, and we were immersed in our own world. Our caddies decided we should play with each other, because anyway, these two silent guys are playing. And so, during the course of our, long walks with golf, Jayendra asked me, like, what do you do? And I said, like, I stare at the screen and then I play the pictures, buying this, selling that, and then make. He said, is this all you do? I said, yeah, I mean, that's pretty much I do. I mean, and he realized he was, like, being a little, I didn't mean it in a rude way, but, like, I just wanted to know, is, like, how do you actually manage to do this day in and day out? I said, like, I completely enjoyed. I really look forward to the next day. I mean, I can't wait to go back and sit in front of that screen. But something there, I think, that left a seed of, thought. Not that I was, that what he's asking me bothered me or anything like that. But I think something, there was some trigger there. And then after some time, whenever his idea of Margaritaram, which is essentially when digital cinema became reality, the ability to actually shoot a concert, full half an hour piece of, it became reality. In film, you could never do that. You had to actually stop, and then it would have never been possible. He was mentioning that, hey, why don't you actually look at the sabhas anyway are not big on technology. You put it mildly. So why can't we give an experience to the viewer as to how actually Carnatic music can visually and orally sound, and then there's born the idea of Margaritaram. And so, like, at that point, I must qualify that I was well in position to actually, that was a good year for me in markets, and I could afford to take a certain call on the risk. Risk involved in the project. And then one thing led to the other, and within 2 weeks we were on the floor in Lady Andal shooting for Margaritaram, which obviously it gave me an opportunity to work with such wonderful people. Biggest joy in facilitating, you are the facilitator, your resources you put in facilitating the project. That is. But biggest joy is in working with so many wonderful minds who we had PC Sri Ram, the camera, the late HD, the audio, Jayendra, Krishna, Jayashri, and all the accompanying artists.
So this wouldn't have happened if you had just gazed at the screen.
Exactly. So if I had calculated an ROI, and then if Margaritaram is going to put an Excel sheet and said my net present value or IRR is suboptimal, and then I'm not going to do it, that would have never happened actually.
So quick one. Normally, the people who are wedded to the process of stock trading, who are immersed in the process of stock trading, like to de-risk themselves, de-risk their losses and cover their losses and all of that. உங்களுக்கு பயமாவே இருக்கலையா இந்த மாதிரி அன்சார்டட் டெரிட்டரியில போய் படத்தை போடுறோமே அப்படின்னு பயமே வரலையா
டெய்லியே அதெல்லாம் நான் பண்ணிட்டு இருக்கேன் So honestly, some of my friends from the markets, they know the So, I mean, give you an example. So, or you have a glass of, it's a classic case of half empty or half full. Suppose you had 100 rupees with you and then you lost 50 rupees in a trade, actually. So you, the typical mentality or tendency would be to look at, oh, I had 100, and then they have to scramble back to the 100. Whereas that's not the reality, you have 50. So what do you do with it? The question you have to ask yourself, what do you do with the remaining 50? Whereas people say, oh, I have to get back to the 100. And I have done that so many times in the past. You dig a deeper and deeper hole to yourself till you realize, you know, you're in this deep mess with, you're struggling to get out of it. Whereas if you had detached and you would say 100, okay, I'm going to risk 50 on this. If it goes, it's okay. When you're left with 50, you're ready for the next step. So it becomes, each one becomes a parcel which independent, which you can handle.
So you decide in capsules.
Yeah, it is capsules. That's the way it works.
You insulate one capsule from
the other. That's the way it works for me. That's my way, actually.
So there's a very important element of learning here. One is that when he says, again, look at his view of life, that he looks at it as a process. Sitting in front of the screen and gazing at it and looking at the numbers is probably one way of looking at it. But he sees the whole opportunity to interact with beautiful minds as his bigger wealth, not necessarily the commercial success of Margari Ragam itself as a venture. You know, if that happens, great. I think that's one big learning, and that's awesome. You know, thank you, Srikanth, for bringing that. And thank the second part, which I am picking up, is this whole thing of can we put the past behind us? When he's talking about money, because that's what he deals in, and money in a unit of 100 and you're left with 50. Now you are living your life and X part of your life has already gone away. Now what are you going to do with the remaining Y part? And you really don't know the length of this Y. And therefore, you know, instead of asking why is my life incomplete or why should I, you know, feel scared of getting into this, take the deep dive, plunge, make the maximum of what is left. I think that's the big message that I'm drawing here.
And the era of demonetization is very
worse, right? How did you stay rooted to this feeling of I want to be a musician? You know, I'm not even defining it as a bliss, because at 13 something, 15 something, you probably won't have looked at it as that five-letter word, that magical word, right? How did you stay rooted with the idea of being a musician?
Actually, I don't even think at that age that I wanted to be a musician.
Oh, you're okay.
No, I think that came much later. At that age, so as I mentioned, at the age of 11, when my parents wanted me to move, I was sort of neutral and I said okay and I went with the flow, but that changed as I became a teenager, and by the time I was 14 or 15, I was fighting regularly with my parents about, I don't want to go to India this summer, and I want to stay here, and all my friends get to play all summer in July and August, and I have to go and I finish school on June 15th, and you're flying me out on the 16th to Chennai, and then I'm back like the 2 days before school starts, I don't get any time. So I was more like that, and you know, so those fights would go back and forth. I wouldn't practice regularly, and I wouldn't go for class. I mean, in the sense, I wasn't keeping up with my end of it. You know, in the U.S., obviously, I wasn't learning when I was there, but I'm supposed to be listening and learning from recordings and practicing, and I wouldn't do it, to put it mildly. And I would fight with my parents that I didn't want to go to India, and my dad would get so frustrated, he would say, fine then, I'll save myself a couple $1,000s, I don't have to send you there every summer, it's costing me money to send you there, I'll save some money and use it for something else. But at the end of the day, I went and I boarded that flight and I would come. So I think somewhere deep down I wanted to do it. I don't know that I wanted to be a full-time musician at that age, I didn't think of it like that. I enjoyed doing it, and I think finally at the end of the day it was something I did want to do. And so when push came to shove, I didn't. He refused to go, and I did it every year from the age of 11. I came to India every single year. Yeah.
Okay. Let's go to your time in college. I think you're very, very candid about admitting that the idea of a full-time musician was not informed. But what happened? Couldn't things have changed for a more stable, predictable career path while in college, possibly because of the fact that you are in an American university, you have pressure, many of your friends are making choices about going to Stanford or Harvard or whatever, or law school, you know, of a particular kind of pedigree. So how did you manage that phase of your young adulthood, late teenage, young adulthood? Was it formative in the direction of music, or was it a struggle there as well?
When I started my undergrad degree, I didn't know what I wanted to do academically or otherwise. I just, as a lot of American kids, I went into the program. I got into a university and I decided to go where I wanted to go. And I just started taking a random assortment of classes, and you know, the computer science classes, economics classes, political science classes, and then I was all over the place doing what a typical American kid who, you know, is not sure what they want to do does. And I think it was actually, we started in September, and I came to India that December and for the music season. And Sanjay just said, "What are you doing now?" And I told him, "I just started university and I don't know what I'm going to do, but it's 4 years." And he and his wife both just said, "Cancel your return ticket. Why are you going back?" And I was like, I laughed and he said, "No, I'm serious. Why are you going back? You could be sitting here and seeing concerts and doing this full time and spend all that time in this rather than studying over there. What are you going to do?" I said, "I don't know." But that was the first time that this idea was planted in my head. And that grew over the years. And so I decided after a couple of years I wanted to be a lawyer. I wanted to go to law school, so I was on that path. I split one or two summers where I did an internship for a month or a month and a half, and then I came to India for a month and a half, and then I went back because I was trying to do both. And I didn't want to fall behind. I needed to compete with my peers there to do the summer jobs, internships, all that stuff. So I was trying to do both. But somewhere in my third or fourth year, I decided, okay, maybe I just want to spend some time in India, a definite amount, and that's going to be obviously for music. I still wanted to be a lawyer, so this was just supposed to be a kind of, okay, get it out of my system and give it a shot and then go back sort of a thing. But that 1 year became two, became three, and now it's 10 years since I've moved here, and obviously I'm not a lawyer, so as you can see, I didn't go back to that.
So the decision to stay on, was it like a flip of a switch, or did it just evolve through this time?
It was so, definitely not a flip of the switch, definitely nothing so certain. I remember I came thinking I'll stay for a year, and I decided that 1 year became two. And after 2 years, I was back home visiting my parents in LA, and my dad on a drive somewhere just asked me, "What am I doing? And how much longer am I going to be in India?" And I said, "I don't know, but I want to stay a little while longer, at least another 6 months or a year or something." And he said, "Well, you've got to start thinking about coming back, and how are you going to put food on the table?" And you know, a couple of the generic things like that. And then he also said, finally, when I had argued back and forth about, "No, I want to do this, and I want to give it another year or whatever," and he finally said, "Well, you know, at the end of the day, there are people who are full-time musicians, and so they make ends meet. The only problem is that I think you could support a lifestyle, but you can't support your lifestyle." So his thing was, you know, being from the U.S. and maybe used to certain things, what we consider luxuries, he said, "How are you? You're not going to be happy sitting there, I think, for the rest of your life, and so I don't know how you're going to do that, but okay, let's see." So he and my mom were both a little bit worried, is the right word. After 3 or 4 years, I started to get worried. And I thought, okay, maybe I should move back to the U.S. But that was, for some reason, my parents had changed their mind by then. And they said, "No, I think things are going well. Things seem to be picking up, and we can kind of see it." Maybe I was too deep in it, and I didn't see any change or whatever. But two people at that time were crucial in making sure that I kept at it. One was my parents. The other one was, of course, my teacher, Sanjay. When I told him this, he just said, "First of all, for the next 1 year, I want you to get that idea out of your head. If you go into anything in the next 6 months or 1 year with that in the back of your head, you're not going to give it 100%. You're just going to be thinking that this is just temporary and I'm moving back. You're not going to do anything full on. So get that idea out of your head. In a year, we'll talk about that. But first, forget about that." then the third thing that happened to me was one day around this time, I got a phone call from Ramani sir. And he doesn't call me. I mean, I go to visit him from time to time, or if my brother goes for class, I'll just go and pay my respects and I'll leave. He called me one day at home, and he said, I just read an article about you in magazine or something. I said, oh, okay, thanks. And he said, not only that, I'm hearing really good things about you, and it takes two things. Of course, you have to have the, whether it's the skill or the talent, and the hard work and all of that, but you also have to have some amount of luck in this field. And a lot of people are talented, but they're not lucky, and I see that you have both, so keep at it. So that was also a big thing for me, that phone call itself. I just put the phone down, kind of in awe that he would say that to me. And he actually picked up the phone and called me. That was a very big deal, I won't forget that. So that was a crucial time, and it definitely didn't happen overnight. This took months of me being convinced. After all of that, after making the decision, I had to be convinced. And things really did change in that year. I don't know if just...
Can you talk about which year is this?
This was probably around 2010, 11.
Oh, so just 10, about
maybe.
5 years ago?
Yeah.
So let's go to that point where you talk about you were worried for yourself, and your parents had begun to see things falling in place. Part of your worry must have come from the fact of how the music kind of circuit here operates, right? I think there are enough entry barriers even for people from here. Were you ever seen as an outsider? How much did that puncture your enthusiasm? And how did you deal with that phase in keeping yourself focused?
I think that was one of the biggest issues in that, whatever it was, 4 or 5 years, the first 4 or 5 years, was that I wasn't looked at as a serious, I won't say artist, but even student of music at that time. That I was just some kid from America who maybe just wants the experience or whatever it was. You know, we do these visits, and it's become very common today for high school kids to come and then they can put it on a college application. So was it just some sort of resume building, or was it just like a hobby? Was I going back? And I literally had so many encounters with the secretaries of the sabhas around Chennai who would see me one day and say, oh, I'm going there. And I'll be like, I'm here, mom, I live here. Oh, yeah, I said, okay. Then like I'll see them 3-4 months later, they'll be like, yeah, I'm that bar. I'm like, I just saw you 3 months ago. And they're like, oh, did you go and come back? And they're like, no, I've been here, I live here. 6 months later, same thing. So it just kept happening. That was really discouraging, and I actually had one sabha secretary call Sanjay and say, you have a student who I've heard sings well, and I was thinking of giving him a concert, but he's from America. I have so many kids here that live in Chennai who want to perform. How can I justify giving him an opportunity over them? So Sanjay just said, very point blank to him, he said, how can you punish him for where he was born, as if he had something to do with choosing in what country he's going to be born. He's chosen to be here now, and he's chosen to take this seriously, and he's been coming. So how can you punish him for that? And if you think he's deserving of a concert, give him a concert. If you don't. That's a different story. So that sabha secretary actually said this story during the concert, which is why I even knew about it. So that was, it's so many barriers which had to do with me being from the US. And
so who helped you during this phase? Apart from your conviction in yourself,
I think it was all the people around me that were.
So Sanjay, obviously.
Yeah, definitely. Like it was the same characters. It was my parents, my brothers, sort of the same people who still encourage me today. It was them. It was Sanjay, and to a great extent, it was Ramani sir, and a lot of family and close friends who just kind of told me to keep doing it, and that it was something different that I was coming from America and doing it. But because of that being so different in the first one, it was also very risky, very scary, and people didn't take me seriously. So that was a very tough part. I wrote an article for the Hindu, I think it was around that time, 2009, and it was called Shedding the NRI Tag. And it was kind of outlined a lot of these things that happened.
Oh, you did?
And that was a big, it came on the front page of Metro Plus, and right in December when everybody, you know, music was on everybody's minds. And I got phone calls and even a postcard from sabha secretaries who said, oh, so you're here after seeing the article. I said, yeah, it's been like 5 years. The article came out today, but I've been here for 5 years. But that helped a lot to get the word spread out that I was, you know, serious.
So follow your bliss and doors open. So fantastic.
Exactly.
Thank you. Beautiful story there of resilience, staying on the path, And I think this is very true of all of us who try to go our ways. There will be times, and you know, Joseph Campbell talks about this in the hero's myth, and this is the basis for all films being made in the world today. That the hero of any story will stop believing in his own potential at some point, and will want to give up, and that's when a mentor steps in and says, "Go on, some more, you know, just last one more day." In fact, we employ this all the time in our lives, as Vani and I hang at the edge of our precipice and try to last one more day. So I can completely relate to what you just said. I'm keeping a watch on time, so this segment that I'm going to talk to you about, you know, we wrap it up very quickly before I go to the audience for questions that they may have. So I'm reminded of this movie called Ye Jawani Hai Deewani, where Ranbir Kapoor tells Aditya Roy Kapoor this dialogue that paisa aap ka mehr hota hai, and Aditya Roy Kapoor replies, "Wo sabko naseeb nahi hota. Money is like the dust of your hand, and the counter is that not everyone has that luck." So on that basis, I'm coming to you with a question. So how do you deal with peer pressure, or do you have to deal with it at all, or do you like don't deal with it at all? When people around you, when maybe family, maybe friends, pretty risk ventures, I think stock, when you can analyze it like a Warren Buffet and say, this company is like last 10 years been performing like this, it's okay, let's take this risk. There's some data available. But whether it's Marari Ragam or one with Krishna, or now your latest baby, the learning community at Quest, which is an exploration center, which is prime real estate, when you're putting in funds there, how do you deal with the peer pressure of the choices you make? Or how do you shut yourself there?
So I think I've basically insulated myself from any pressures. Obviously, when people tell you it comes from a sort of concern, beginning from my parents, my father particularly, when it's like when you do what in your early age, something like what I did, with, like, you know, getting into something with like stock broking, which is so high risk, they were very concerned. I think. So I've heard from many times during the time I was not doing well, he has told me this before, right? Not go back to a job. So that's like a recurring theme of people, especially that comes from a from concern actually, of they are wanting to see you do better. But the overriding thing is a certain feeling of what a selfish feeling of what you want to do for yourself, which keeps you going. It's sort of you know, for good or bad, some disregard some of these you know, peer pressure. But the other thing I've never fallen prey to is comparing myself with you know, others in the field. And so you could, that could be a big driver for many people actually, that I want to be like, say if you say Warren Buffett, or you know, if you talk to Indian markets, or there are like all people there who are up there, and then I want to be, you know, bigger than them. That honestly has never been a driver. It's like what I am today, what I want to be tomorrow. And so this is another thing which I have not really fallen prey to, because it's I'm a lot happier in whatever I'm doing, which enables me to take some of these decisions which are not major, but which are beautiful, and which enable some very, very nice.
Beautiful, beautiful. I pick up two strong learnings there. One is never compare. I think most of us are running a race thinking that we want to beat somebody. There's nobody to be beaten. There is nothing to be claimed. There is nothing to be held on to. You know, that's the reality of life. So you're very blessed to be engineered this way, that you don't have the comparison virus running in you. And the other learning is that when you have to, it's your life. It's your life. And you have to do what you have to do. And therefore, in a way, you are responsible for everything that you do. I mean, you don't have to necessarily say no to perspective, but it's not necessary that you always get bogged down by perspective. I think that's what I'm picking up. Quick question to you, and then we'll go to Sandeep, and then we'll go to the audience. Very quick one. How do you deal with insecurity, worry?
Just set apart some time for it.
Beautiful.
Which is like, you know, sometimes 3 a.m. in the morning you wake up and yeah, that's something you're aware of, you go through it. So these come in phases that you're not free from it, but just be aware of it, go through it, and then it just passes on. So I usually set apart some time for it.
Brilliant. Osho talks about it very beautifully. He says, don't push away worry. Let it come. Alamadi varu. And then alamadi put. Watch it go away. You know? The moment you hold it, it's going to stay with you.
I wish it was a different time. It's 3 a.m.
3 a.m. Okay, Sandeep, to you. When you now look at your career, you know, it's been about a decade now that you've been here, and it has been kind of a fascinating story to see it evolve the way it is. Yet that's the romantic side of things, right? On the very practical side, there are bills to be paid, there is a home to be run, and you are in a line where you've got to work doubly harder than those that get a paycheck at the end of every month. So how do you manage this tightrope between being as accomplished a musician as you are, and yet having to live in the real world?
Yeah, it's not easy. It gets easier, I suppose, but there's definitely been tough times. I recall an incident which happened maybe 6 years ago, sometime around then. I got an invitation to perform somewhere in Europe, I think the Netherlands. But it wasn't a pure classical concert, and I kind of had to do 2-3 performances, and it was sort of out of my comfort zone, and also not something that I wanted to do. So out of the comfort zone is okay if you want to do it, but it was also something that I wasn't too keen on doing, but they were going to pay me really well. So it kind of kept coming back that, oh my God, how can I say no to that, and especially at a time when I wasn't performing as much as I am now, or getting the opportunities to be more financially secure as I am now. So I made a phone call to my guru, to Sanjay, and I told him what was happening, and he said, today it's X amount, tomorrow it's going to be 10 times that, the day after it's going to be 100 times that. You don't draw the line, you have to decide not based on the money, but based on, do you want to do it? You know, so it has to do with that, not about what they're paying you. Is it something you want to do? Then you can even do it for free. You can do it for $1, $1,000, or $10,000, $100,000, that'll keep growing. But can you, at the end of the day, live with the decision you've made, and be happy? So then I said no to that performance. And I'm very glad that I did, because I've stuck to my principles and I've done programs which I wanted to do. Of course, we do things along the way which afterwards you think maybe I shouldn't have done it. But at the time I went into it convinced I wanted to do it, so I can feel good about the decision. There have been very tough financial times as well. And there have been times when I've gone back to the US and worked for 2-3 months, contract work with an old boss who said, yeah, sure, come on back and work for a few months while you're visiting and get back. And what would happen actually is he would say, how long are you here? And I would say 4 or 5 weeks. And at that 5th week, I would say, you know what? That paycheck looks really good. Maybe I'll stay another 2 weeks. And I would extend my ticket. And I'd get another paycheck. And I'd say, okay. And it would just go on. And then I had to really put my foot down and say, wait, I'm not trying to become somebody who gets this paycheck. I'm losing my focus here. I'm supposed to just be supporting myself to be a musician. And then I would cut it off and come back. So there were those ups and downs, definitely.
Beautiful, beautiful. I think Sanjay's played a bigger influence on you, not just as a teacher who taught you music, but as a person who taught you to lead your life with dignity and purpose. And I think this is a very, very important point here, that you cannot capitulate in a commercial sense and sell your soul. And I think that's the big learning here, but taught so beautifully by Sanjay, that it's not the money, it's what gives you joy. And I think if we answer You know, I was talking to Mr. Madhu here, who's invited me to speak at his club next week, and I gave the topic as Help Yourself to Happiness. That's what I'm going to talk about. And, you know, he wondered how are you going to talk about this in 20 minutes? And it doesn't take 20 minutes. It takes just a minute that you can be happy if you choose not to do anything that makes you unhappy. That's all you need to do. And that's what I'm picking up from young Sandeep over here. Your rapid fire question, only one, the same one that went to him. Insecurity, worry, how do you deal with it?
I think he had a pretty good answer. I don't think it's something that you can just, you can't ignore it. It's there, everybody has it. You kind of have to embrace it to a certain extent. You build on it. I think that there's a time or times when artists have breakdowns because of insecurities. And maybe you're doing a great job, and if you could just ignore everybody else and everything else, you would be fantastic, but you can't. And that's when the insecurities creep in. I think then you have to kind of kick in an extra little boost of confidence, wherever you get that from, if it's the people around you, or if you examine and do a deeper analysis of what you're doing and what you're trying to do. A little bit of extra confidence in those moments of insecurity help to get over it. So like you said, it comes, you have to address it, and then you kind of get over that and you move on. You can't let it take over.
Very true. You can't let it take over. Very, very true. Thank you, Sandeep. I want to just acknowledge the presence here of two very, very important people in the lives of our guests. One is Geeta, Srikanth's wife, and she's hiding somewhere behind there. And she runs this amazing not-for-profit organization called We Can. And we also have Radhe somewhere here.
She's there.
Yeah, Radhe hiding somewhere
Radhe.
There. Radhe is an accomplished dancer herself. Very, very accomplished dancer. And she said she always hides in Sandeep's concerts, so this is not a concert, you can move to the front. Okay? So there we are at 8:05 now, and we will open the floor for questions. Thank you, it's been a wonderful conversation. We'll take questions from the audience. Please remember that your questions have to be questions. Do not offer comments or observations, and keep your questions to... For example, don't ask Srikanth investment tips. Please do that offline. Okay? So don't ask Sandeep to tell his what is his favorite raga and stuff like that, dissect a raga. Keep that offline. Keep it to the zone of their bliss and their journeys. I think that's more important. So I saw the first hand go up there. Vivek, yes?
This question is for Sandeep. Sandeep, I want to ask you, while you're in this journey of following your bliss, I want to know how you deal with criticism that comes your way after every concert that you perform, because I think that's very, very crucial for an artist to know what people are saying and how you're being rated and how you're being judged. So I really want to know, is it coming the way of your journey, of this bliss journey, or is it?
No,
happening.
Definitely doesn't get in the way. It's also, again, something you don't ignore. It's one of those, it kind of creeps in as an insecurity or sort of a worry. You have to take the good and the bad with a grain of salt. I don't place a lot of value on 100% praise or a very good review in a paper. I read it and I try to take something that'll make me better or approach the next concert in a better way, so more constructive. And I do the same thing with a negative review. I don't sit over it for days. I read it maybe once or twice, and I see what the points they've made. And I try to analyze if there's some truth to maybe some of the points that are raised. And if I disagree, I disagree, and I'm more confident with what I believe in at the end of it, I suppose. And then if there's something that I feel I need to change because maybe it's been addressed or maybe it's been brought up more than once, or it's something that even I kind of thought and it just confirmed it, then okay, yeah, I was right all along. So you have to take both the good and the bad, sort of with a pinch of salt, that you can't just place too much importance on either side of it.
Beautiful. Beautiful answer. I saw a hand.
Yes, question.
Yeah, yeah.
Yes, question, Srikanth. Your photograph on the banner shows you holding a large SLR camera. Is that your next bliss or the current bliss?
So, actually that's one of the... in talking about association with people, so I got introduced to nature photography through an association with a few friends who actually were investing in the stock markets through me, and they had wanted to buy an expensive camera. They found me as the conduit to actually do it. So this friend of mine, Dr. Chidambaram, he took me to Vedanthangal, thrust one camera in my hand and say, photo it up. Then I was handling it, it was a nice camera. And I got a couple of good shots, and I said, like, I mean, I was really, hey, this bug again bit me. And then next thing he knew was he's ordering this huge lens, which you see in the photo, actually. And before I knew it, I had this big, 500mm lens with this camera sitting here with me, and I was like, oh, what have I got myself into? But you know what happened subsequently? It's like, you know, it's something I've traveled the world, I've traveled many places with it. It's given me so much joy. Again, the process of taking the photograph, sharing with people, getting their admiration for that. It's been a huge part of it. So it has been a part of the bliss. It's something which I never sought, but it has come my way and I went with it. Yeah.
Beautiful. Next question. Yes, sir. Gentleman in the red shirt.
Congrats, Srikanth and Sandeep, for being chosen as the Bliss Catchers. I have this question to Mr. Srikanth. I just wanted to know whether money makes a difference to pursue your passion. Assume that if you have not been successful, do you think you would have really pursued this passion?
It's a very relative term, actually. So obviously, in the present role as a facilitator, as an investor, it goes without saying that you should have the capacity to do it.
No, I asked this question because Viswanathan was mentioning, but I'm sorry, I have some problem with my memory. The gentleman who wanted to make that film, because he said money was not an issue. Chittagong.
Chittagong.
Now, I'm talking of the general demographic. How do you pursue your passion? You think if the money had not been there, you would have really gone into all this thing, being generous or going into taking those risks and other things? Does it not the comfort that yes, I have the money, fallback is there? Otherwise, would you have done it, or would you think anyone could do it?
Let Srikanth answer and then I'll come in.
So I think it's a very relative thing you're talking of. When you say generosity or a scale of some things don't need money actually. For you to learn music, for example, you just could go online, you could learn. On the contrary, what the line of opportunities that has come to me, or people who have come knocking on my door, have obviously, they have come to me because they know I can facilitate a process, I have the resources for it. That goes without saying. So therefore, that if anything is to do with a certain amount of money I have, the association with people, that's a given. But having said that, it's, the thing of giving is nothing to do with how much you, I remember the days when we were struggling, we had no ends, money to make even ends meet. We did, facilitated education of a boy in the school opposite your house, and that changed my life in a deeper way, and that's something which gave me so much satisfaction that when I had more money, I pursued that on a much larger scale.
He runs the not-for-profit Onvius Foundation. You can Google that and find out. But here's my perspective, sir. Very simple. There are some myths going around, and if you've been a regular at Bliss Catchers, you'll find that many of these myths are busted. Myth number one is that people that follow their bliss don't necessarily make money. I think it's completely untrue. We've had many, many seasoned, people successful financially who have been here on this show. The second myth is that when you are making money, when you're earning a living, okay, not even making money, when you're earning a living, you can't follow your bliss. And I think that's also untrue. We've had many people here who talked about their journeys. And the third is that you have to make your money to follow your bliss. In all three contexts, if you dig deeper into our life, Vani and my life, or you dig deeper into Sandeep's life, you find that all these three myths don't work. I'm completely broke to the bone right now, but I'm the happiest person I can say for myself. And why? And only because of what Sanjay taught Sandeep and what Vani and I discovered for ourselves, that we have not capitulated. We have not moved away from the zone of our bliss. And therefore, I think they are two very, very different things. I'll draw three imaginary circles here. And those who have been at the show before will relate to them. The first circle is your circle of passion. What are you deeply passionate about? The second circle, what can you be world-class in? And the third circle, what drives your economic engine? Now, we start our careers with the economic engine. So this receives primary focus and in a way consumes too much of our life. Whereas if you start with passion, Sandeep, okay, you start with passion. In a way, Srikanth, while his passion was directly linked also to the economic engine, okay, passion and become world-class at it. Then the third segment, economic engine will fall in place. Take Rahman, classic story. Take Virat Kohli, classic story. Take Mr. Bachchan, classic story. And so, you know, take Sandeep, classic story. So we're all here to prove, disprove that fact that there is no time. And the more you delay this, the more you're postponing living. That's the only point I'd like to make. I can take exactly one question. Any hands going up? I'll go with Geeta. Geeta's hand went up first. Sorry, Ati.
No,
sorry, Dr. Chari.
Sadhivi's question is to you from time immemorial, part to Marmo. How much has this divine union helped each other grow in your personal lives?
What a beautiful question.
Can you just repeat
the last one? Yeah. How much has this divine union helped the growth of both of you and Radhe? Oh, okay. So somebody, when I introduced her just before, I was saying she's a Bharatanatyam dancer. So a lot of art in the house. And I said, yeah, sometimes too much. It's good because we both support each other as artists. I'm never going to look at her and say, what are you doing with your life? How can you be a full-time artist? Because that would be very hypocritical. And same thing when she looks at me. So we both support each other's pursuit of the arts. I think in that way it's very encouraging. It's very mutually beneficial. We help each other. But there's also times where we can be critical of each other because we know a little too much about arts at the same time. And about the work we put in and the output of it. So there's those times as well. But I don't know, I think overall that's also a good thing in the end. And there are times where she comes up to me and says, why did you sing that, or I don't like that, or what is that? And I'm told, you know, somebody said that's good, don't listen to them, stuff like that, because she knows music. And then similarly, I see her go to class and I see her in a performance and I might criticize her on whatever little I know or whatever I've seen her put into it. And I think that only makes us work harder and kind of makes us look at our music, which obviously, because we have that relationship with each other, that makes us closer, that we have somebody on a day in, day out basis that we can rely on for honest, unfiltered advice and feedback.
Fantastic. Thank you. Beautiful question there. Let's now go to the quiz segment. And before I launch the quiz segment, let me quickly make a few announcements. There is no Bliss Catcher event next month. That's the one time of the year when we take a break because we want all of you to come back here and shop at this lovely store, and there'll be a lot more merchandise in this real estate that Ashwin so generously gives all of us. So please keep coming back to Odyssey, because if it's all happening, it's happening at Odyssey. And the other announcement is that we do have Bliss Catchers on the 28th of January. We are entering a third season, and the third season is curated all the way till March at the moment. So 28th of January, we have the tale of two Pradeeps. Pradeep Chakravarti, McKinsey consultant turned heritage expert turned heritage tour leader. And the other Pradeep is Pradeep John, Tamil Nadu weatherman. So we got two of them, so it's a tale of two Pradeeps, 28th of January, the last Saturday of January. Many people ask me, how do you stay in touch? You can take my business card when you leave from here. If you leave us your mobile number, we can put you, add your email ID, we can put you on our mailing list and on our broadcast list, where I blog daily and I share my learnings on life daily. You can also look me up on Twitter and on Facebook. So do stay in touch. And if you're thinking of a Christmas gift, you know, R.B. Rajan, I think, went away. He taught me this thing that as an author, I must promote my book shamelessly. So if you're thinking of a Christmas gift for somebody, New Year gift, it's a beautiful book. Talks about lessons from life. Please pick it up and enrich someone's life apart from my publishers. So on that note, we'll go back to our two guests for the quiz questions. And once the quiz questions are done, we'll do a wrap and we will be ending on time. So, Sandeep, your question to the audience.
Okay, my question. With the December music season around the corner, and I don't know about all of you, but I'm getting ready for it. I thought I'll ask a season-related question. In what year did the music season start as an organized conference?
Badri.
1929.
Very close. That's the year, I think you're saying the year that Music Academy was inaugurated. But we had a music conference start even before that. So should I say the answer or?
You can say the answer. We'll still give him the button.
Okay, yeah.
Was it close?
It's 1927.
1927.
And so, basically with the start of it, they realized they should start something like Music Academy. So,
Badri, can you come forward, please? If you had been off by a decade, you would have not have won the one. But
very close. Yes. As soon as he said 1929, I knew why.
That's the year of the Music Academy being launched.
28 or 29.
So Bhatri is a regular at Bliss Catchers. And happy he's getting his... So your coffee will taste blissful. More blissful, when assuming it's already. Srikanth, your question.
Yeah, so this my friends in the stock market are debarred from taking this question. And I know who you are, so you all heard of Sensex. The Sensex went up 2,000 points, 1,000 points. So the Sensex is comprised of stock prices of how many companies?
30.
30. Gentlemen at the back.
Ramesh said 31st? Ramesh. Ramesh, please come forward. Sorry, sir. He answered it first. We don't have buzzers yet, Ashwin. If you're listening, we can probably have buzzers. And a giant... So the answer is 30. 30. 30. I'm going to invite T.S. Ashwin to come forward, please. And I'm going to have Ramesh come back here for a special reason. Ramesh, can you come back here? Ramesh, as I told you, is our Astana Bliss Catcher.
Attendee.
Without him, Aramichulama. That's the way we will say when we talk to him, when we see him. So on behalf of Ashwin, Vani and me, here's a small token of our love for you.
For not missing even a single
question. Full attendance, good price. Thank you so much. And can we have the discussion mugs for the guests also, please? Thank you so much. I'm going to do a wrap after this, so this is not like a word of thanks. But since Ashwin is already here, we thought we'll...
Sure.
Move that segment forward. So what a fascinating evening of learning. I never thought you can learn so much about life from the stock market. Not everyone develops the kind of detachment that you have. And thank you for reiterating some of those thoughts for me. And Sandeep, thanks for being, so rooted to what you believe in and being so candid about your journey. Because many of us think that we look at people that are up there, that have been there, arrived, done that, and we think their journeys have been easier than ours. We don't think that that they don't, they've not had difficulties. We often think, I think this conversation today really talks about the journey from the point of view of dealing with the insecurities the way they have to be dealt with. You have to see them, you got to place them aside, and like the famous R.D. Burman song, you know, from Pariche, is it? Mujhe chalte jana, musafir hum yaro, bas chalte jana. So you have to keep walking. I'll close today's session with a beautiful, perspective from my favorite Rumi. Geeta is all ears. So Rumi says this, and I think you will. 13th century Persian poet. I think he had the original idea of Follow Your Bliss, because he said that, why are you crawling through life? Have wings, fly. That's what he said. And he also said that gamble all that you have for love. Gamble all that you have for love. Half-heartedness doesn't get you anywhere. It doesn't make you feel majestic, he said. Now, what he's referring to is, gamble all that you have for what you love. And you have, and I have, only this lifetime. But yet we keep thinking of the whole journey of life as, and what we have, as the material wealth that we have, which we are not going to take with us. So Rumi's point is that gamble all that you have for what you love. And only that will reach you to majesty. Which, what is majesty? He's not talking about fame and money and glory and Antilla and all those things. He's talking about the majesty, the joy of living life fully, being in the moment and living life fully. So I'll leave you on that note, ladies and gentlemen. Think about what you can gamble for what you love. Good night. And have a great, great, great music season. I love you.